This is Laws 11057, Introduction to Law. We're up to week 10. We're dealing with a number of issues tonight. I'd like to start by discussing chapter 10 of The New Lawyer, which deals with self-management skills. I'm very keen for this to be interactive. I'm keen for you to come in and make comments or ask questions. Please do that live or use the chat facility as always. In dealing with self-management, we're dealing with issues that might, on its face, not seem particularly important for a law degree. After all, we're here to talk about the law. But if you think about it, dealing with issues to do with self-management is probably the most important part of what is comprised in your law studies or what might be involved in practicing in law in a real sense. After all, it's no good to anyone, yourself included, if you know the law, but you're not able to manage your skills carefully enough to ensure that you practice the law appropriately. So when we talk about self-management skills, I'm really talking about those fundamental issues that are important, which create the whole platform upon which you can then practice law appropriately and well. So firstly, we need to talk about issues to do with things like mental health and self-management and dealing with being able to cope under pressure. Many of you would have your own techniques for doing that now. I'm very keen for you to share your thoughts and to share your ways of assisting. And I will just ask whoever it is who hasn't muted their microphone, if you could do that. It's coming through as Galaxy S5, but there may be others as well. All right, so it's a given that if you're going to practice in law, you are going to be under pressure. There are different degrees of pressure. People cope with pressure in different ways. Sometimes it might be as simple as trying to absorb the pressure by simply saying, I can feel the pain, I know there's pressure there, but I'm going to cope with it, and I can cope with pain, that's okay. Can anyone tell me if they've already experienced that in a work type situation or a study situation where they've felt the pressure and they've derived or they've developed ways of coping with that pressure, and you might like to share that with the class? Come in live or use the chat facility. So I've already said that one way that you might cope is by knowing that you will be under pressure, so you're ready for it. Picture yourself on a sports field with a sports coach who has an enormous medicine ball in his or her hand and says, here, get ready to catch this. What are you going to do? You're going to get yourself physically and mentally ready to catch this enormous and heavy medicine ball. And the way you do it is you focus your attention and you're ready for it. In a way, you're getting rid of extraneous issues that may not be relevant to this task of catching the medicine ball. So psychologically, you're getting yourself ready. And what else are you doing? Physically, you're getting yourself ready. You're putting yourself in the brace position and you're ready to catch this ball. So if you're going to seriously practice in law, whether it's commercial or litigation or anything else, you need to mentally and physically get ready to go, because it's going to hit you. And if you're not ready, it's going to knock you over, because it's a pretty heavy medicine ball. So Aaron says, believe in yourself. Concentrate. Clint says, keep work separate. So these are different psychological, if you like, mechanisms that you need to adopt and be ready to put in practice in a real life situation. Jennifer says time management skills are important. Anything else? I would say preparation is important.
I was going to say understanding what the worth is at the end of the day. How much are you willing to invest? The 80-20 rule sometimes applies.
Absolutely. Thanks for that comment, Vicky. So it's a matter of maybe considering the end product, what you hope to achieve, and then work backwards. I think that's really important. The 80-20 rule is important. You know, you don't want to do it. Well, Maria says, I take a deep breath and just go for it, face it head on, go for broke. I think that's really important. Look, we hate to say it, but sometimes you learn best as a result of making mistakes. And it's a matter of managing those mistakes. Sometimes you've got to be very careful to ensure that you don't let the mistakes get to you too much. Otherwise, it could break your spirit. We see that in criminal law. I often sentence or ask for a lenient sentence, allowing for the magistrate or the judge to ensure that that whatever order is given does not crush the person. But you've got to think about yourself as well. You don't want to be crushed as a result of your mistakes. So try to learn from mistakes. Look, I think I've probably told you about my keys in the fridge philosophy. Give me a nod if I've said that before. No? We have. Sharon's nodding. She's heard the keys in the fridge. Why would you put the keys in the fridge? Why on earth would a lawyer bother putting keys in the fridge? And what's that all about? I'm getting some quizzical looks. I think Sharon knows. Does anyone else know? Yes.
You mentioned in one of your earlier lectures, you did say that you put it in the fridge because your wife told you to bring some milk home tomorrow.
Exactly. Gold medal, Sharon. That's right. Now, why would you put your keys in the fridge? Because you don't want to forget. You've had that one experience where you've come home, you've forgotten to do what your wife asked you to do, and you felt really bad about it. You felt defeated and you felt a bit crushed because you'd tried so hard all day and you just forgot what this one little thing was. And it hurt, and you didn't want that hurt to come back again. So what you thought is, I've been hurt, I don't want it to happen again. What practical strategy can I adopt which will ensure it doesn't happen again? So next time your wife phones and says, can you please bring home some milk? What do? You get the milk, you put it in the fridge, you put the keys in the fridge, and that way when you come home, you must remember it because for about 3 minutes you'll think, oh, where on earth are my keys? Where are my keys? And then it hits you and then you think, oh, yes, I did this as a very practical strategy to ensure that I get something done which is important, which I don't want to forget, and I worked backwards to get to this point where I knew there was a risk I'd forget. Okay, so the same context applies, whether it's in work, if you're going to court, if you're doing something. You know, if you know that you must wear a coat and have a tie to go into the Supreme or District Court, it doesn't matter if you've done hours and hours of research and prepared your case so thoroughly. It doesn't matter if when you get to the court, you haven't got your coat on and the judge says, I'm not prepared to hear from you. Go and get a coat. I mean, what have you done? You have spent so much time and effort, toil, sweat and tears to do the legal job right, and it's failed because of a practical issue. So when I talk about understanding what the end result is, you've got to think back and think, all right, what do I need to do, what do I need to have in place to achieve this end result? And practically, how am I going to ensure that I do it? And at the end of the day, if you've had your coat on and you've prepared your case and you've delivered everything just as you'd planned, you're going to feel great about it instead of feeling absolutely miserable and broken and defeated simply because you didn't have your coat and it was just a horrible, horrible day. Okay? So lots of planning, preparation. Now, it is important, and I think this is probably the most important part of the whole lecture series that I'm going to give you. Forget about the law. Just think about how you're going to achieve a good result for you and your clients. You know, depression affects a lot of lawyers, especially solicitors. The text will say 1 in 3 solicitors will suffer depression. 1 in 5 barristers will suffer depression. So why is that? Now, I'll tell you, I think part of it is because sometimes people just aren't interested and they're kind of coping and they're going in automatic pilot and they really don't want to be doing what they're doing. Maybe that's one reason. I'm not purporting to be a psychologist or a social worker here. Maybe that's one reason. Maybe another reason is that people are being a little unrealistic in terms of their expectations. Maybe they're practicing in an area that's really a little bit too tough for them, or maybe their interest level doesn't match the expectation, so maybe they need to readjust a bit. Why else do you think solicitors are so prone to becoming clinically depressed? Personality type, maybe that's a factor as well. Maybe it's because people haven't prepared enough. Maybe they haven't thought about what they need to achieve at the end of the day and worked backwards. Maybe that's a scenario. Who else can think of reasons why a solicitor may be so prone to becoming depressed? Work-life balance, Maria? Yes. So how do you achieve a proper work-life balance? Well, I think what you've got to do is not moan about it at the end of the day and say, oh my goodness, I didn't have a proper work-life balance, because I think you're only entitled to say that if you'd actually thought about it before the event and thought, okay, I do want to retain some fitness. I do want to retain some health. I don't want to put on a lot of weight. I don't want to be consuming a lot of alcohol and illicit drugs. So what am I going to do about it? Work out a plan and work backwards from there. Erin says, maybe if too much of a perfectionist. And I think that's a really important point. If your expectations are unrealistically high, then it doesn't work for you. Maybe you need to invest some interest in someone else. Someone else's life, says Clint, and that's a really good point. Jennifer says, just beware of taking on others' problems as your own, and that's a really important point. You've got to be objective. Look, I mean, the sad fact is that I lose through suicide probably one client a year, just because of the nature of the work that I do. And very often I'm dealing with very emotionally upset and disturbed people. That's in the criminal law field. If you're in family law, you're going to have that as well, or child protection. So you've got to be a little bit independent of all that. Now, keep the rope in the freezer. I don't agree with that one, Clint, but thank you very much. We'll treat that as a comical. Thank you, Clint. All right. Are there any other suggestions?
Yeah, John.
Yes, Steve.
Perhaps some lawyers are portraying a side to themselves that they really don't want to. So, for example, a criminal defence lawyer, maybe he or she has to defend a child molester, and maybe he or she doesn't really want to defend that. And so they're portraying a side of themselves that they really don't want to.
Yeah, sort of having this internal battle constantly. Yeah, that's a point. I think it's important that you understand what your role is and why you're doing this. And if you really can't reconcile that with your own personal values, probably best if you consider doing something different. So that's a great point. Thank you very much, Steve. So do take care with substances. Do keep up your health. Maintain a healthy lifestyle. At page 356, there are some strategies for developing a system that works well for you. I've mentioned before, for example, that if you're overwhelmed at the amount of reading, then one strategy that you might like to consider is my use of the yellow highlighter to be very selective and careful about the way in which you go about your studies. Now, try not to work too far from behind, whether that's in study or in practice. Inevitably, as a lawyer, if you're in practice, you will always be behind. It's a matter of being not too far behind. I was told that as an article clerk in the very early 80s by one of the partners in the firm that I was in, and I can say from now, it's absolutely true. I can honestly say that there has not been one day of my working life where I can honestly say I'm now up to date. Not one. And it's a matter of managing that and not being unrealistic about it. You will always be behind. Don't be too far behind. Feedback at page 360. It won't always be positive. Don't go into life in your legal career thinking that everything that happens to you will result in positive feedback. There will be times where you are criticised, whether it's from a court or a partner in a firm or whoever it might be, or a client, take that in your stride. Can I just say, this is probably the biggest, this is the most important sentence I will say to you during introduction to law. Remember the big picture. If you could do that for me and just keep a nice balance, okay? There will be times where you want to throw it all in, but just remember that big picture. So resilience. Resilience is a really important factor for a lawyer. You know, we talk about the new lawyer, and I think it's a great philosophy. James and Field is not just about telling you about the law. We can all do that, but they really talk about what it means in a more global sense to be a lawyer, and learn to harness the stress is one aspect of resilience. Adopt a do-it-now attitude if wherever possible. Try to avoid that too-hard basket that almost every lawyer seems to have in the office, and prioritise. You know, in the criminal law jurisdiction, in the higher courts, in the district court and Supreme Court, we very regularly are summoned to appear at what's called a callover. And a callover is where the, let's say, the district court judge asks all the legal representatives to attend without clients, and the purpose is to prioritise and reprioritise the cases so that the judge gets an idea of whether this particular case is ready, are there any pretrial arguments, how long will the matters take, are the witnesses ready, do we need to have a jury, or will there be a no jury, as in the case in children's court matters, etc. So a callover is used in that context. Now, you should practice having a callover for yourself in your own practice. So you've got a massive amount of work to do. You've got bits and pieces everywhere. You're a little overwhelmed. You're a little stressed. What I'd recommend is that you try to place like with like. So at least you have all your files with whatever papers are relevant. You gather them from around the desk, put them on the same file, and then you can prioritize the files. Then working becomes a lot easier because all you have to do is go to the top file and work on that. You've already done that process of planning and organising and being prepared. All right, so are there any comments in relation to resilience or self-management skills before we move on? Okay. All right, now, if you could just chat amongst yourselves for a moment, so to speak, while I find my notes in relation to what I'd like to do tonight. And here we are.
Is this the hint that we need the green sleeves elevator music for the next 6
Yes. Seconds? Thank you very much, Peter. Yes. No, we're right now. We're right. We don't need to worry about green sleeves now. All right. Basic skills. I'm just going to go back to chapters 6 and 7 of The New Lawyer. Research skills. we've had some great contributions from Catherine and Peter and Michael in terms of providing some advice about legal research. But let's go and have a look at The New Lawyer. It says, basic skills, you need a systematic approach to research. Know where to look. I gave you the exercise of finding the criminal code and the Australian consumer law early on. And the reason I did that was I wanted you to have some significant places to start looking in the civil and the criminal jurisdiction respectively. Obtain good quality information. Obviously, you're all familiar now with LexisNexis, Thomson Reuters, CCH and Austley, as well as Comlaw, etc. Read actively and efficiently. I'm going to suggest that what you should consider doing is, at the start of your research, essentially doing some speed reading, some glossing through, and that's as opposed, so that's really what we call scanning as a lawyer. So do some scanning as opposed to what we might call perusal. So perusal is detailed reading. So it depends on the circumstances. And then applying your research. So second point is plan your research. And I don't know when Catherine is back. Catherine is back from the UK, if that helps. Now, planning your research. Identify the task at hand. For example, are you drafting a contract? Are you drafting a deed or an opinion or pleadings? And then identify the specific area of law. Now, this is not necessarily easy. When you're doing your legal studies, you'll have one course on contract law, one course on torts law, one course on criminal law, etc., etc. But bear in mind, in a very real sense, these concepts, these areas of practice are intertwined and very often in relation to the same matter. So it may be, for example, that you have instructions to issue proceedings on a debt, but it may be that you need to look beyond mere contract law. It may be that there's some sort of liability which is tortious. It might even be criminal. It might be a consumer law issue, so that the Australian consumer law comes into play. So just be very careful about coming to a quick conclusion that this is a contract matter and only a contract matter. You need to consider more widely than that. I may have made this comment before in relation to conveyances. Bless their souls. Conveyances do a really good job in difficult circumstances. Doing conveyancing is not easy by any means. I don't practice in conveyancing anymore, but I admire people that do because it's hard work. But conveyances are just a little bit, sometimes, we've got people with the blinkers on and they'll only think in terms of contract law and they'll forget about those other options that might be available. So be wary about coming to a very quick conclusion. Look, as part of the research activity, I think you need to brainstorm from time to time. You need to think about different options that could be relevant to this particular research issue. Consider other factors such as the time frame, the cost, and the consequences of the advice that you're giving. So, for example, it may be that a particular client has a great case but suffers from an intellectual disability which would effectively make it very difficult for that client to pursue the course of action that someone without a disability might be able to pursue. So commence with broad reading. Use those Boolean connectors, director's duties and duty of care. Consider the primary sources, legislation and cases, and the secondary sources, commentaries. I think I've mentioned I generally go to the primary sources first, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's right. Be careful not to spend enormous amounts of time in wasted research. So do try to do that speed reading first, and then maybe come back and do the perusal, as I've described it, on a second reading. With the detailed reading, once you get to that stage, be very careful and be prepared to slow your reading down to snail pace for a period of time. Watch out for very special words like and or but or unless. Things like that can just throw the context. If you gloss over a word like provided, then you could embarrass yourself by not having picked that up. And I'm very aware of the fact that I'm, in a sense, giving you a mixed signal. I'm saying don't waste lots of time on reading. Gloss over it. Use speed reading techniques, etc., etc. But, I don't know, think of yourself. This is a silly analogy, I know. But think of yourself as you're on an alien spaceship, or you're on a spaceship and going to an alien world, and you're hurtling through space at a million miles an hour at the start, looking at everything. But once you get close to what you think is relevant, this, you know, the planet that you want to land on, everything slows down. And at the moment we're about to land, we're really, really slow and careful. So that's the best analogy I can think of off the top of my head. Sorry if that's a bit silly. So be reluctant to necessarily jump into immediate conclusions. Now, at page 16 of A Practical Guide to Legal Research, there's a quote that I think is really good. There are legal implications aligned to so many so-called simple facts. Sometimes people say, oh, this is a really simple matter, but just be careful because there are legal issues that flow. I think the example in the book was someone comes to you and says, look, I'm charged with a drink driving offence. Here's the reading. Can you give me some advice? Well, just bear in mind, of course, that a drink driving offence for a person on a learner's permit might be different to a person on a provisional license, might be different to a person on an open license, might be different to a person who has been disqualified by court order from holding or obtaining a license. So there is not necessarily going to be one answer, and you need to be prepared as part of this brainstorming activity to ask other wider questions which may have a relevant bearing on the advice that you give. All right, now does anyone wish to make any comments? You'd be tired of listening to me prattle. Are there any comments or questions? Nothing on the chat facility? No, I'm looking, you're all going, yes, we've got that.
Come on, seriously, you think we'd ever be tired? In a nutshell, context, as you, which I think is what you were getting at then. And no, the other one is with the speed reading and the detailed reading, what came to mind for me is you're just always conscious of the purpose for the research and the amount of time that it's taking. Now, you do have a job. No, it's not. You don't have an endless amount of time to do it, because your clients are only going to pay you for so much time. So you have to be as productive as possible.
Oh, they're great comments. I really appreciate that. Thank you, Peter. Because you've got a responsibility to the law. You've got a responsibility to yourself and your family. You've got a responsibility to the client. But gee, I wish people remembered that you've got a responsibility to your employer as well. That's the employer in me talking there. But yeah, you're right. You've got to balance all those factors. To some degree, you need to be prepared to be assertive. And there's nothing wrong with saying no. It's all too easy, particularly as a young practitioner, to say yes to everything. Yes, I will do that today. Yes, I will only charge you this amount. You know, be prepared to say no. It's really important. And that's important from a resilience point of view as well. All right. Thank you for that contribution. Any other contributions? Any comments? Okay. All right. IRAC. There are different acronyms that are used to describe the process of legal reasoning and legal research. I kind of like IRAC. IRAC. Does anyone else? FIRAC. I assume that means the facts, Clint, the issues, the rules, the application, and the, I'm not sure what Q is that meant to be conclusion? Yes, says Clint. Any other acronyms that people particularly like or use? All right. So IRAC, we all know about that, don't we? Determine the relevant facts as a preliminary issue. Vicky says, I like putting the conclusion first. I like that. I do that quite often. Acquire, apply, and identify. I don't really understand that one. Sorry. Do you wish to expand on that one? Syrah, conclusion, says Jennifer. Issue. Okay. See you, Gabby. Acquire the information. Yep. Thank you, Clint. Apply the information, yep. And then identify the conclusion, no doubt. All right, so citing your research, I'll move on from IRAC, but I think we all know that. Citing your research, the Australian Guide to Legal Citation, it's quite complicated, but have a look at it. Do you understand the basics of this? So firstly, when we're citing research, generally speaking, you don't cite the selectively cite in the body of the text, but often use footnotes. When you're mentioning cases or legislation, please type it in italics. I do get a bit tired of saying to people, please type it in italics. There's a difference between the round brackets and the square brackets when we're around the year. Does anyone know the difference? So I'm talking about a case, and there's the year of the case, 2014. Sometimes you'll see it in round brackets and sometimes you'll see it in square brackets. What's all that about?
John, was that something to do with it being published in a volume as opposed to the year that it was available or published?
Spot on. That's great. Yes. Specifically, it's this. Vicky says, square is the date of ascent. No. Erin says volume. Yes, I agree with that. Sorry, Vicky. The situation is that if there is a volume, then the year will be in round brackets. And if there's no volume and it's a reference only to the year, it will be in square brackets. Now, you'll note that I had to look at my notes to say that, so it didn't rattle off the top of my head. So if you see, the Queensland reports, the state reports of Queensland used to have a reference to a volume, so you'd see the year in the round brackets, but I believe they don't now, and I stand to be corrected on that. So if there's no volume, the reference to the year will be in square brackets. All right, so this specific referencing, pinpoint referencing, for example, Dietrich against R, round brackets 1992, close round brackets 177, that's the volume. CLR, Commonwealth Law Reports, 292, 292 refers to when the case starts, comma 299, the 299 refers to the pinpoint reference to the page in question. All right, don't give me the URL. I'm not interested in the way in which you accessed it through the internet. I want the legal citation. I think we all know that now. There are some examples in the New Lawyer at pages 256 and 257. All right, I'll need to move fairly quickly. The Myrat, M-I-R-A-T, Myrat, Myrat question. Oh, Vicky, so in terms of the way in which we cite cases, sometimes the cases are referred to not only by the year of the case, but also a volume number. So I've just given the example from the Commonwealth Law Reports that the case of Dietrich against the Crown, which is Dietrich v. R, that was actually decided in 1992. You can have a look at this one if you like. So there's clearly a reference to 1992 in the citation. 1992 is in round brackets, and the reason for that is that in the Commonwealth Law Reports, apart from the year of the case, they also catalogue by reference to a volume. And in this case, the volume was 177. So the citation for Dietrich is round brackets 1992, 177, CLR 292. Does that make sense? Thumbs up, Vicky? All right. Okay, thank you. All right, then we have the Myrat method. You need to identify the material facts. Now, that can be a little difficult if you don't know the law. The research may not necessarily be linear. One thing you can do to assist you in trying to determine what are the material facts is think about preparing a chronology or perhaps some sort of logical list, and that might help to identify what's missing. If you're trying to identify what's the material facts, often you'll start questions by things like who, what, where, and how. So that's the first part, is the facts. Secondly, identifying the legal issues, criminal law or civil law, identify similarities between the problem and a legal rule, key terms. And don't forget, this is often overlooked, that there may be relevant state law and relevant Commonwealth law. So be careful that you don't fall into the trap in pleading a particular case only to plead your case under state law, because perhaps you should have pleaded it under Commonwealth law as well. All right, so then the third is identify and interpret the rules. We know about that. Go to legislation or case law. Number four is apply the rules to the facts. And this comes back to some of the legal reasoning that we talked about. Reasoning by analogy, which is similarity, is to do with precedence. Inductive reasoning, which is broadening out, is where you're looking at a specific principle to form a general conclusion. And the converse of that, under the heading of applying the rules to the facts, is deductive reasoning, which is where we're narrowing. We're taking a general principle and bringing it back to a specific conclusion. All right. The second issue was identifying the legal issues. The example in practical regard to legal research in the second edition is to do with family law issue for child abduction. And in the current issue, we have that issue of refugee status. Either one works. Whether you've got the second edition or the third, don't worry. The example that the authors give you throughout the book will work just as well. It's just that the third edition's a little more up to date. Okay, I'm just going to gloss over quite a lot of my notes here because I'm taking too long. I had a lot of material to talk to you about in terms of interpretation skills, which is Chapter 7 of The New Lawyer. But I suspect that many of you are studying statutory interpretation. And it's for that reason I can say that there won't be any questions on statutory interpretation per se in the examination. But there's a lot of good material there in Chapter 7, and perhaps I can leave it at that in terms of comments for tonight. All right, but we haven't finished for tonight. Are we hanging in there all right? Yes? All right. Now, just move your neck around because I need you to think now. Great, thank you. Get ready for this one. All right, question one. We have a request to provide advice to a client. The question is, and there's been some really good discussion on UCRU about this, to what degree do we provide the advice? How holistic should the advice be? So we have a situation where a client comes to you and says, I wish to pursue a debt. My daughter owes me $5,000. I lent her some money to buy a car. She bought the car, but she hasn't paid me any money. What can I do about it? Or I want you to act for me. So let's just think about, and you can come in live or you can use the chat facility. What are the sorts of things that you could advise that client to do? What are some of the legal remedies? What do we do? All right, I'm watching for the chat facility. You've got a client wants to sue her daughter, his daughter or her daughter, for $5,000. Jennifer says mediation. Great. I'm really pleased to see that. Given family members try alternative methods first, and I think that's really important too. So what we've identified there is two things. Firstly, it's a legal issue. You don't have to go to court. There are different ways of doing it. And secondly, we've identified the relationship between the client and the party on the other side, and we've given some due reference to that. So alternative dispute resolution, try a family member first. Are there any other issues which might not necessarily be legal issues? Yeah.
Can I just come in there and ask? I put it up on the site today when I posted some of my responses to this question.
Yes, Erin.
Can a solicitor... basically be an informal arbitrator when you have two people, if you can get them together and sit them down and just be an arbitrator for them? Can a solicitor take that role on?
Sure. But you need to be a little clear on what you're doing. So it might be, for example, that you're acting for the, let's say, the father, and you might suggest to your client that we try and meet with the daughter and try to broker a deal that way. But you need to be really careful about it. Make sure that the daughter is aware that you're acting for dad. And secondly, and here's a really important part, you don't want a situation where the daughter alleges that there was undue pressure and that it was unconscionable, that not only is she having to deal with dad, but now dad's brought in this lawyer and they're both pounding her. So that can lead to complaints. But yes, that can occur. One thing that you might consider doing is encouraging the daughter to engage a lawyer or bring a support person along, things of that nature. But yes, Erin, there's no reason why you can't do that. Thank you. You'd have to be careful if the other side is represented, then you can't deal with them. You'd have to go through the lawyer. That's just one caveat to that. All right. Now, Josh says, well, look at a payment plan. Yes, very good. So what you've done is you've considered and you've given some advice for the client to consider an alternate economic mechanism to having this matter resolved. So it's not necessarily a legal issue, but what you're doing is you're highlighting a number of factors, and that is the costs of litigation, the risk of litigation, the potential cost to the relationship as a result of pursuing this matter against his daughter. Any other comments?
Yeah, John, I've got a question there. So even though the scenario you've just given, there's no written contract, so how would that go in a courtroom if the judge says, well, there's no written contract here?
Sure. In contract law, which you'll come to, you don't have to have something in writing for it to be enforceable. So an oral contract can be enforceable. Now, of course, the daughter might say, look, it was no contract. This was a gift. Dad gave me this. The fact that there was nothing in writing might work against Dad if he's now alleging that it was in fact a loan. I'll just mention a couple of things. Just be careful to ensure that the instructions you received are not in circumstances where you are concerned the client is acting on emotion or is acting illogically. So it may be appropriate advice to ask or invite the client to just take a moment to think about it rather than necessarily moving today. I think you need to cater for the individual circumstances of the client. Those circumstances might be intellectual, socioeconomic, they might be to do with the age of the client. For example, to take an absurd example, if you had a 14-year-old client came in to see you and said, I wish to issue proceedings in the Supreme Court for defamation, you may wish to factor into the instructions the age of the client. I'm not saying you won't, it's never happened, but in my experience anyway, but that might be a relevant factor. Cultural factors might be important. The client's risk perspective might need to be considered, and capacity issues. So if you have a client who's borderline intellectually disabled and this person has received a very substantial compensation payment and says to you, I wish to lend all of my money to my friend, are you under a legal obligation to do a little more than just say, yes, my task is to draw up a loan agreement and here it is? I think you need to be careful about that. And the Legal Services Commission, I think, would ask a lot of questions if there was ultimately a complaint that all of this money was lost because your client instructed you to prepare a loan agreement and that's what you did. You need to think more laterally in terms of giving advice beyond what the client might ask for. So to come back to the example of someone saying, I wish to lend money, you might say, well, have you considered alternatives such as purchasing the property in question and then leasing it out? Or have you considered alternatives such as taking security over the property to support the loan? Now, the Legal Services Commission will say that you are not doing your job if you don't think about these issues and raise them. So one thing you might want to do if you've got some extra time is have a look at the website for the Legal Services Commission. Have a look at those cases where lawyers have been prosecuted and perhaps penalised for doing the wrong thing and work backwards from that and say, all right, well, I can now see that this is what I should do because that's what's regarded as appropriate for a lawyer in those particular circumstances. So identify the difference between what's ideal and what is realistic, and that's all part of what I call this holistic approach to the administration of justice, to the way in which you look after your clients. So I think that as an advisor, you should consider both legal and non-legal options, which might be available for a client. You need to tailor that to the individual needs and circumstances of the client. You need to provide a number of different options, and one of those might be providing information and education. It might be discussing the legal services to a specific problem. Are there appropriate self-help remedies? Should you refer the client to an ombudsman, for example? Are there specialist legal services that might be available? So a client with a disability might be referred to the Queensland Public Information Clearinghouse for QPILCH for advice. Do you provide do-it-yourself kits? Are there ethical concerns that you're charging substantial amounts of money for something which is easily done for a client who has the capacity to do so through using a self-help kit? I'm not saying these are necessarily the answers, but just raising the questions. So another example of where you might be called upon to consider what might be regarded as non-legal alternatives is this. A client comes to you with a contract, says, I wish to buy this property. I'm purchasing it from the developer, and the developer, which is a company, has offered me a guaranteed 10% return on this investment for a period of 5 years. What happens if you say, yes, that looks fine, the client signs, and then 6 months after paying the money, the client comes to you and says, well, I haven't received any of that 10% guaranteed return because the guarantee was given by a company, and I now find out that that company had $2 to its name and it's gone into liquidation. Would the Legal Services Commission say to you, you should have gone and done more in your advice to the client and talk to the client about the risks associated with dealing with a company which may not have any money behind it? The legal services might say, well, holistically, you should have asked the company directors to guarantee the performance of the obligations of the company. So these are things that should be considered in that more holistic sense. All right, if your client wants you to litigate something, obviously you need to talk about costs. Now, when lawyers talk about costs, we're talking about legal costs. And can anyone tell me some potential risks associated with the issue of costs?
Yes, if you take it to court, you lose. You might be asked to pay the other party's costs.
Exactly. Thank you very much, Erin. Yes, Peter?
Erin just stole what I was going to say.
There you go.
I'll just write a message for you. Just holistic advice is also considering, is also advising the client that this legal action is not the best option at this point in time. Now, if they lose, they may actually lose more than they could potentially gain.
Exactly. Thank you very much, Erin, and thank you, Peter. Josh says, suing for more than what the other party has. Clint says, time. These are all relevant factors to consider. There is also...
I think also, John, a really important one there is the emotional cost to you of going through something like that needs to be considered as well.
Absolutely. And again, tonight on a number of occasions, I've stressed the importance of working back. So you've got to ask yourself questions. How will I feel if after 2 years, the client loses the case, loses the fees to me, suffers a costs order to the other side, and then complains to the Legal Services Commission that I didn't give that client advice about alternatives, such as going to mediation. So you've got to be a little bit pessimistic in amongst the optimism, and you've got to be a little bit realistic as well. You've got to, and you've got to cover your butt. You've got to give your advice in writing and make sure that you outline a number of options for consideration. Remember, of course, that it's not your decision, it's the client's decision. All right, so
John,
thank you very much. Yes, Erin.
I know you're in a hurry, John, but can I just ask you, can you tell me the difference between the Dispute Resolution Branch of the Justice Department and QCAT?
That's good. Good question. All right, so QCAT is the Queensland Civil and Administrative Tribunal. It was established in 2009. It came about as the result of an amalgam of a number of tribunals, I think 26 or so, which had previously operated separately. Those tribunals include the old Guardianship and Administration Tribunal, the old Queensland Building Tribunal, racing tribunals, etc. So a whole range of tribunals were merged to become QCAT. As part of QCAT's role, there is a considerable emphasis on alternative dispute resolution. So many QCAT matters are referred to mediation. That can and often is done in-house by QCAT members such as me, and a genuine attempt is made to resolve the matter on that basis. Alternatively, the matter of the mediation can be referred to outside agencies, and in particular, the Justice Mediation Service that Erin has referred to is an agency that does mediate a lot of disputes, not just QCAT disputes, but disputes of a wide range of issues. They might be employment issues, or they might be neighbourhood disputes or workplace issues, etc. So the Neighbourhood Dispute Dispute Resolution Centre, which is loosely annexed to courts, is separate to QCAT and exclusively deals with mediation issues. Some of them may be the subject of QCAT proceedings, but not necessarily. Does that answer the question, Erin? Thank you for that question, Tom. All right, so it's really important that you provide advice to clients in relation to other options such as courts or tribunals or ombudsmen. Look, very often, Maria says, about holistic advice, if we offer alternatives to a prospective client instead of suing, that wouldn't make our employer happy because they want billable hours. Look, I understand what you're saying, but actually I'm not sure that I agree. You'd be really surprised. I mentioned earlier that quite literally, I've never been up to date. So I think you'll find in practice, generally speaking, there's more than enough work to do, and quite often it's a matter of managing that work. And you do want to get a good outcome for the client, and that makes for a happy client who'll refer work to you. And if the best way to resolve the issue is to go to dispute resolution, sure, it may not generate as many fees as litigation, but I think your employer will congratulate you rather than penalise you. And I'm not just saying that. I genuinely believe that's the case. All right. Look, if you've got a dispute situation, I think one option is to say, well, maybe you should consider walking away from the dispute. I know it's important to you. I know there's a fair bit of money involved, but think about the time, think about the emotion, think about the relationship with your daughter. Is it worth it? One option might be to say, let it go. Remember, you're not making the decision. You're generating options for the consideration. Another is to say, well, look, try and resolve this by a direct approach. How about organising a cup of tea or a beer or something with this other person? And forget mediators, forget lawyers, but encourage the client to make that direct approach. That's another way of resolving the issue. Then we escalate and we go to mediation. And the mediation can be through, as Erin said, the Alternative Dispute Resolution Centre. It might come about as a result of going to a court or a tribunal and then being ordered to go to mediation. Or the mediation can be a commercial mediation involving highly paid solicitors and barristers, etc. So mediation can be more the neighbourhood type mediation service, or it can be the high powered in the CBD, expensive option. All right, can anyone else think of, just generally speaking, other alternatives from a holistic perspective that a lawyer might consider giving advice to a client about to resolve a dispute? And you can put something on the chat facility, or you can come in live. I've mentioned a few things. I've said, well, maybe one option is to walk away. Maybe an option is to have a direct approach. Maybe another option is to organise a mediation. What other options are there?
Maybe if it's between, like you mentioned before, a father and a daughter, or father and son, he can just adjust his will.
Excellent. Very good lateral thinking. Great. Thanks, Erin. You're not advising the client to do that. You're not saying this is the best legal solution. You're offering it as an alternative, and it's a very good alternative. And the client will thank you for coming up with those sorts of ideas. Any other ideas, alternatives? How else can clients resolve issues? Maybe go to the Member of Parliament. Now, I'm not saying for the debt issue, but maybe it's something that really shouldn't be going through the courts. Maybe it's more a political issue. Any other suggestions? Vicky says, well, can you use the car yourself? Instead of dollars, can you come to an agreement which provides a completely left-field alternative way of resolving the issue? And that's a good way of going as well. What about making...
John?
Yes. Yes, Peter.
You could also take the issue to the media as well.
Absolutely. Look, you want to use that selectively, but at times that's a really effective way of dealing with things. And going to the media might put pressure on the other side, but it also might attract people to come and assist you in your cause. Maybe making complaint to appropriate authorities, the ACCC or the government ombudsman. And there are a whole range of ombudsmans that you should consider. Telecommunication industry ombudsman, banking ombudsman, insurance ombudsman, superannuation complaints tribunal, the legal services commission. So there's a whole range of different authorities that might assist you. The workplace ombudsman. Other alternatives? What about police? Maybe in some circumstances it's a police matter. Can you report the car stolen? Rego doesn't prove. Yes, Clint's come up with that type of idea. Maybe it's actually a criminal matter. I'm not sure you'd do that, but yes, Maria?
If the client's indigenous, don't they have elders that can mediate? So like the elders in a community, if it's indigenous or, you know, one of those clients?
Yes. So a specialist type of mediation, is that what you mean?
No, I'm talking about if it's indigenous, if your client is indigenous, don't they have elders that sort of mediate between between the community?
Yes, and the elder? So bring in the elders.
Yeah, the elders,
that's
yes.
Yeah, that's a great idea. Yep, lateral thinking, but could be very effective and could result in the clients maintaining good relationships. So thank you for that. Maybe if your client suffers an intellectual disability to such a degree that the client really does not have capacity to make appropriate decisions, part of the advice might be to members of the family to make an application to QCAT for the appointment of an adult guardian to make decisions for that particular person. Maybe some agencies, specialist agencies, can assist your client. Maybe your client is an elderly gentleman and may be able to access free legal advice through the Seniors Legal Advice Services. Maybe you can refer your client to financial counselling. Maybe sometimes there's a third party with deep pockets who should be considered as part of the litigation. Maybe, in fact, it's an insurance claim. So maybe that's something that should be considered as well. And then, of course, we've talked about costs and the issues associated with costs. All right. So that's all I wish to talk about in terms of brainstorming. The point of tonight is really this. Make sure that you work backwards. Think about what you want to achieve from a professional perspective and think what you need to do that to maintain equilibrium and good mental health and physical well-being. And then also from the client's perspective, work your way backwards. Think about what does this client really want to achieve and are there different ways to achieve that? So, all right. Are there any questions or comments before I wrap it up? Thank you very much for your patience. I know it's been a long session, but I really appreciate your hanging in there. I'll now stop the recording and we'll see you next week. Thank you.
John, can I just ask...